agenda, but Cedric, will you begin us with item one?
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. First item on the agenda is the appointment of chair and vice chair. Can I have nominations for the chair?
Second.
All in favour?
Might we have the nominations for the vice chair?
I'll nominate your chair.
Agree?
Yeah.
Very good, thank you. You have the agenda papers. And we have, as you requested 2 meetings ago, Jane Kennedy, our police commissioner here. Would it be all right with the meeting if I suggested that I summarise the report which we commissioned from Tony Kinsella as a background to inviting Jane to speak? We can then open up to questions, and maybe at the end of our triumph into Egypt, isn't it? Thank you very much. That's great of you. The cupboard was open. And then we can go back to our agenda and start taking the minutes and the rising and so on. And then there is on the agenda how we follow up what Jane has said and what's in Tony's Kinsella's report, some of which I believe is available to everybody. Are people happy with that line of our meeting today? Very good. All right, can we begin, the two items to begin with, is for me to remind you what are the main findings from the analysis we asked Tony Kinsella to do on antisocial behaviour? And he set this within a background of the crime rate in the world and how crime and antisocial behaviour rates affect the world as a whole, and Birkenhead in particular. You'll see from the summary that it gives you the data on the snapshot on crimes, including antisocial behaviour, which means all these are unreported figures. We don't have data on the people who are so tired in reporting events that they give up. These are on the data that's available. And we see on crimes and antisocial behaviour that 1 in 10 rural residents were affected during the last calendar year. Secondly, if you look at that, while 1 in 10 for the whole of the world, it's 1 in 10 for Birkenhead. And if you look at reported crime, 45% reported crime is in Birkenhead, although we only have 28% of the rural population. So it's heavily concentrated, and that's why you and I as MPs have been raising this as an issue concerning our constituency. The next area that Tony looked at for us was antisocial behaviour. And we've got a downward trend in the last 4 years, which is good if those figures are to be trusted and in a sense reflect what is going on, rather than persistence of people reporting things. But what you will see is the decrease in Birkenhead is less, substantially less, than overall in the world, and particularly in compared with other individual constituencies. You'll see that a lot of this, while not totally governed by these data, a lot of it is probably committed by younger people, in that the big issue that comes through the report is rowdy behaviour. There clearly are other problems about neighbours, noisy neighbours and so on, but there's clearly an issue with how people conduct themselves in public. And you will see at the back of Tony's report, he does a summary of the research into what works. And he raises some big questions about what does work, but does underscore the priorities you've set as a constituency committee and as constituents, that it's good anyway to look at the first stages of life. But if we want to change behaviour in the long run, the big digging actually has to be done there, rather than thinking somehow the police will be able to turn up and save us. We certainly want them to quell the disorder, but they're quelling and not dealing with root causes. So that's the background to what I read from Tony's report. As I say, we'll come on later in our agenda to what we might do about it. But can I welcome Jay Kennedy, who's our police commissioner, who's come this evening to talk about this topic. And we will then open up for questions afterwards. Can I hand you this microphone?
Thank you, Chair. And it is, I feel, enormously privileged that it's not just that surprise me that your Chairman feels as a cup of tea, but the fact that I'm the only other person who has one is a mark of true respect, and I do.
We know we're powerless.
Thank you for inviting me to the committee, and I'm sorry I couldn't attend 2 months ago. I had another commitment. You asked me to focus my presentation on antisocial behaviour. Before I do that, I'd like to introduce Bill McAdam, who is here from my office. I know that Inspector George Minnelly is in the audience, my inspector. And if I get really stuck, I'm hoping you'll be able to help me answer it. What I thought I would do is quickly give you some figures on antisocial behaviour here in Birkenhead. Again, rattle through my role as the Police and Crime Commissioner, and then maybe look at how I can help the force and you to tackle antisocial behaviour here in Birkenhead, and then move to questions and comments. And I appreciate that's the bit where you want to spend, and I want to spend, the most time. It's really important for me to hear from you, and I always value the opportunity to speak to you and to hear your feedback. So I'll try and move along as quickly as possible. Now let me, if I just ask Bill, I have actually got some data here, which is the most up-to-date figures that we've got. I think there's probably enough for around the table, and maybe one or two for the audience, or maybe we can share them one between two as we go around. Maybe if I have step one. And what you'll see is these are the what we call the crime statistics, reported crime as reported by the force, cut several different ways, as compared with the previous year, as compared with the calendar year, as compared with the financial year, and month on month. But they all relate to the 70s area, which is what most interest to yourselves. I think one thing I would say to you as you have a look at these figures, they do confirm that depending on how you look at them, they imply that, well, certainly antisocial behaviour appears to be down. All crime, the indications are to us, all crime is up. The Home Secretary focuses on all crime. But at the moment, she's still saying it's down, because over the whole country she's presenting that case. What I would just ask you to think about while you look at these figures is that Merseyside Police receive calls for help through their telephone call centre. Around about 1 million calls for help per year. Only about 90,000 or so actually end up as recorded crime. So I just want you to hold that thought, because it gives you a sense of the workload that the force carries that actually is not related to these figures at all. And although we tend to focus on the figures as a measure of performance of the force and its partners in the area working to fight crime, in fact, there are a lot of other calls that are made that the police have to respond to. So I just put that thought in your minds. These figures that you'll see are examined by other organisations such as local housing providers and the local authority, and at a regular antisocial behaviour governance meeting here. I'm sure by the force that this meeting looks at reports of antisocial behaviour, not only reports to the force, but also to other organisations, civil rights and housing associations and others, who will receive reports from their tenants. And that meeting devises strategies to deal with the antisocial behaviour as it is being reported. I think I'd like to say at this point that I am a little concerned. I think I can give you my reassurance that every quarter the methodology of collecting the figures and recording the crime is audited within the force, and I have seen a report as to whether the figures that we're receiving are reliable. So I hope I can reassure you on that front that the figures are accurate. But what would concern me around antisocial behaviour, and maybe you can give me some feedback on this, my perception is that as there are fewer officers in neighbourhood teams, there are fewer opportunities for people to report antisocial behaviour, and it may be a factor, only may be a factor in the numbers coming down. I think we should also take some reassurance from the work that we've all been doing, working together as partners, that that is having an effect and is starting to see results. So, my role as the police commissioner does not allow me to interfere with the operational activities of Merseyside Police. It is my responsibility to hold the Chief Constable to account and to set priorities which he and the force must then work to deliver. I do that through the Police and Crime Plan, building on the Police and Crime Plans that the Police Authority had in place in the past. And I know from speaking to many people in meetings of this kind that antisocial behaviour can blight lives. I remember it from my time as a Member of Parliament. And I know that antisocial behaviour, the impact of it, can be horrendous. In fact, in Tony's report, he does talk about how different kinds of antisocial behaviour in different circumstances can actually, although we might grade it as slightly less serious than others, the impact can be just as devastating. So we need to be alive to that fact. So that is why I made the first of my priorities when I was elected to be to reduce crime and antisocial behaviour. I have some limited resources available to me to help fund various projects. I've got a fund available called the Police Property Act Fund, again carried on from the Police Authority. That arises from the sale of property which has come into the police's possession, but where the owner can't be identified or where a court order has been made. It's a very much smaller fund than it has been in the past. It's designed to give one-off grants of up to about £5,000 to community and voluntary organisations that are making Merseyside a better place to live. I'm particularly mentioning it this evening because we have an opportunity for organisations, if there were any represented, to bid to that fund. The fund is open at the moment for bids. The deadline for applications is the 10th of June, Wednesday the 10th of June, and the application forms are available on the website. Now, I mention that because some of the organisations that we fund using this help give material assistance to the force and the local authorities and housing associations in trying to combat antisocial behaviour. If I could give you one example of a good project that has yielded some good results. One project that I've helped to fund was Positive Futures, again well known to the Police Authority in the past. It operates in Birkenhead. And Positive Futures engages with young people who've offended or are at risk of offending. Maybe they have issues with substance misuse, including alcohol and potentially solvents, some of these so-called legal highs that we now talk about. I've brought with me a case study of a young man provided by Positive Futures, which outlines our own Colin Stewart. He was referred to Positive Futures by Merseyside Police following a number of problems he was associated with in the Grange Road, Charing Cross area of Birkenhead. He was interviewed at length by Wirral's antisocial behaviour team, and he expressed an interest in joining the army and in sport. If he carried on down his current path, he was never going to be successful in either. The antisocial behaviour team referred him to the Wirral Sports Development Unit, which works in partnership with Positive Futures, and he began to engage in the services provided. I think that's key. He actually got involved. I'd like to quote to you an account that was given to us by Paula Baker, who's the project coordinator for the National Citizenship Service Scheme. She says this: "We assumed that throughout the citizenship scheme, Stuart would engage with only the outdoor pursuit element and then he would drop out of the programme. would engage with the community aspect of the programme. But this was absolutely not the case, despite the fact that he was in a group consisting of other young people he wouldn't normally associate with outside of the scheme. He worked with the team, motivating and encouraging the other members of his group through every activity. Each day, Stuart took the lead on all activities, proving himself to be a role model for other young people to aspire to. Staff members also commented on his approach to the activities and how his enthusiasm rubbed off on them, even in an intense and tiring residential environment. She says one particular memory was when he had to pitch his social action idea in front of 45 young people. He'd never done it before. His group decided to raise funds for a local elders' luncheon club, and when presenting, the group struggled as a whole to get their ideas across. There were members of the group who knew Stuart outside of the scheme and did their best to disrupt his presentation. They were laughing at him in an attempt to put him off. But despite this, he took the lead on the presentation. He didn't acknowledge his peers. He pitched to the panel his group's idea. And when presenting, he stood proud and professional. And this is still her quote. It proved he had matured hugely in the 4 weeks of the scheme. He didn't let any of his peers lead him astray throughout the presentation, or in fact, throughout the whole of the NCS programme. And that is hugely to his credit. I just thought I'd put that out to you as a success story of a young man who had responded well to the collective work that we've been doing here in Birkenhead. And I understand, although it's been 18 months since his referral, there have been no further reports of his involvement in antisocial behaviour. So that's an example of three agencies working together that has been successful. What I think we would get most benefit from is examining what more we could do together to achieve more successes like that, especially given the scale of cuts that we are, I'm afraid, anticipating. We are anticipating a further, what we call an in-year budget cut. So we've set the budget for this next year, but we are anticipating that in July the government will make a further cut to the police budget. So we are braced for that. But as I said, I want to spend as much time as possible answering your questions, so perhaps this would be a sensible place for me to finish. You've got a copy of the figures, we can talk through them, and we can talk through some of the issues raised in Tony's report.
Great. Thank you very much, Jane. Thank you again for coming. We are going to come back later on to the recommendations in Tony's report. One important one of which is to actually consult real people on the ground, the sort of measures they would like us to be spending, on which we could spend any additional money. So we will be coming back to that. But can we, first of all, before we start the debate, can we ask for questions to Jane? All right, yes. Person at the back.
Sorry, Jane, it's just on your report there.
Could you say who you are?
Sorry, I'm Julie Smith from Sport Development, working with the NCS programme as well. Dr. Stewart is now going forward as a volunteer. I've been right up with the NCS.
Good. So I just mind being identified, but I didn't think you were. Well, that's terrific news.
Really? Name and organisation?
Well, Hayward, I represent me. Thank you, Frank. Listen, I put three questions out to the chair of the police commission, commissioner. The three questions were one about the use of community support officers and police officers and specials. Did you receive them?
No, I haven't seen them.
Okay, that's a problem. Okay, the questions were, speaking off the top of my head, I don't be going to Birkenhead on a bus on a Friday or a perhaps Saturday or during the evenings. And I see quite often community support officers walking the streets of Birkenhead. I see them quite often. I see two of them together. They're always together, and they stop young children. I've seen them many times stopping children in the streets and talking to them. these are community support officers, two of them together.
Yeah.
I also see police officers walking the streets of Birkenhead together,
yeah.
And I see them doing their job and their function. That's very good. Both of them are high visibility. My real question was, why don't you split them? Why don't you have a community support officer and the police officer together so that they impact on each other, so they can assist each other, so they can actually be in a car with each other? So that would share out the number of police officers across the whole of Birkenhead with community support officers. My third question to you was, the utilisation of police specials. The question was, within that, what is a police special? I basically know basically what a police special is. And when I asked the police officer about them, they tried to explain to me what they were. Now, to me, they say that community support officers aren't trained up to the skill level of a local officer, police officer. Now, this would assist the community support officer in actually progressing through the service if they became specials with the necessary training, which then would assist the police officer. And then one question is to you.
Now, there's two comments and one question, certainly in the middle one.
Try.
Just to remember, your question has actually come to us.
Has it? Yeah.
As against the jet. It's here. It's on the report.
We were trying to sponsor there as well. Yeah, we were trying to improve on that, but we've actually, the question was addressed to Jane, wasn't it? Jane.
Yes, it was addressed, yeah.
Right. Without wanting to repeat what's in the report already, which I have seen.
Which point about splitting up?
Yeah.
So that the support officer has the authority, someone with them, to arrest any of you.
In years past, when PCSOs were introduced, we had more of them and we had more officers in neighbourhoods, there would have been more resilience to be able to pair officers with PCSOs. The bare truth is that now that is no longer the case.
You're wrong. Because I see them walking the streets of Birkenhead, I see them, they're there, they're visible, they're doing their jobs. But the problem is, as just Frank just said, it really should be interlaced together, and that would give the community support officer an avenue of promotion in so much that they then could become police specials.
Give them the authority.
Yeah.
Which community support officers come. And even if there's not one for one, one could start with something to do with this, couldn't we?
First of all, that route into the police is primarily the most successful route for the candidates who are joining the force. Although we just entered a period of no recruitment. As officers, we are still recruiting PCSOs and people who have had experience as special constables or as PCSOs are usually most successful when it comes to applying to be a full constable. So we've seen quite a significant movement through into the force from the PCSOs. So you're right in the sense that having that experience helps. But what you have to hold in mind is they are doing different jobs. Leaving aside the specials for the moment, police officers, even working together in a neighbourhood team, are performing slightly different roles to the PCSOs, whose primary focus is engagement and listening and communicating and gathering information. Arresting, responding to reports of crime is more, they all do it, but primarily that's the job of the sworn officers now. I'm going to ask the inspector if she would mind saying what the force policy is in terms of patrolling, and I don't think there's a bar on them patrolling together, it's just a matter of how they are deployed on the ship.
The question actually came
to ourselves,
right?
Absolutely.
In relation to it, stand up. The question did come to us and we provided a response. I mean, effectively, as the neighbourhood inspector, I have no concerns with patrolling police officers and PCSOs, but as the commissioner has said, they do perform different roles. roles. The PCSO is primarily a visible role, engaging with the community, listening to the community, being out on foot, whereas we have less police officers, I'm sure you're aware, and those police officers have to respond to incidents, and primarily they do tend to be in police cars. That is not something that I want PCSOs and my colleagues. PCSOs don't go with vehicles as a rule. There are exceptions to that. So PCSOs patrol on their own in singles or in pairs after a certain time. We tend to patrol in pairs after 6 o'clock in the evening. And the police officers, as I say, they're responding to incidents as a rule. The PCSOs are out there gathering intelligence and engaging with the community. I don't have a problem with them patrolling together if we have those resources available.
Georgie, could we ask for a response that you would experiment, and that those community support officers who regularly report to their superiors that they get hassle on their rounds and they don't have the authority to actually nip things in
Absolutely.
The bud?
And we could
actually, some of those, to actually follow up Paul's suggestion, which I think is a good one.
And we do respond. There are incidents where we do have PCSOs who do have hassle in the streets, and we have an immediate response from police officers in that instance. But and can I just say in addition to that I myself have patrolled PCSOs. And my sergeants go out with the PCSOs. We do that. Mr. Hayward hasn't seen that, but it's something that we do.
No, I've not seen that. I've seen.
Not at all, but.
I've seen your community support officers giving assistance to the third people on Mount Road and Borough Road and Woodchurch Road with a handheld gun, a camera gun for speeding gun.
Yeah, but Georgie, if you could take that away, it'd be really good as a suggestion.
There was one last question that the gentleman had, and that was the questions around the specials and the utilisation specials.
Yes.
Is that okay?
Please, Jen.
Well, it was only just to say, I think you've probably got a definition of what one is in the papers.
Yes.
Primarily, they are volunteers who come in but are fully trained and equipped to work as a fully sworn constable. So they do have powers of arrest, but they are volunteers. They are receiving expenses only for the work that they do. That's right. And you suggested PCSOs aren't trained at the same level. PCSOs are trained. We invest heavily in making sure that our staff are well trained. But they're trained for a different role. So we've already covered that, really. And I think if we're taking away the idea that you suggested it's...
All right, very good. Yeah. Jane, thanks. Any other questions or contributions?
I'd like to ask... if I may, my name's Stephen Andrews. I just represent the community where I live. I live in the St James's, it's in St James's ward. And we've had a lot recently of antisocial behaviour from a particular gang of young lads who are aged between the ages of 14 and 17. Now, one of the questions that people keep on asking is why the police station in Laird Street was closed down. I know the answer is going to be because of lack of funds, but when police officers have to, come from the main station here in Birkenhead, when there's a perfectly good facility there, why can that not be utilised at least for part of the day?
I think Laird Street has been affected. Certainly. Most police stations were closed to the public in terms of general inquiry desks some time ago, certainly before my time. But Laird Street was proposed, there was a long discussion, wasn't it, the police authority, I'm looking at Maureen here, around how to invest and bring Laird Street back. I consulted on a strategy for police stations like Laird Street last October and November, and the public supported the idea of disposing of a building like Laird Street, which doesn't lend itself to modern-day policing. Dispose of the building, but find in the neighbourhood, before we dispose of it, a place where we could have a community police station where a regular surgery would guarantee to be held by the force. And that's the plan for Laird Street. It's going to be quite some time before we do that. And in the meantime, the facilities at Laird Street, I'm told, are really very poor. So if the force isn't using it, it's probably because it isn't fit for them to use. It's not condemned or anything, but I don't think it's a very comfortable place.
Okay, so Laura, do you want to come in on this?
No, not particularly. We don't have long discussions. I think the issue that we discussed was that the plans for closure went ahead before the alternative provision was located, and I think that proved a difficulty, certainly in Rockferry and in Laird Street. So that was the issue, really. As the plan went forward, these alternative provisions weren't identified, and from what I hear you saying at the moment, I think that's still the case. Is that right?
Well, I wasn't aware that. I knew that Laird Street was occasionally used by the force, but not to any extent. It has been closed a little bit for quite some time, and the proposal was always to try and find an alternative facility. So we haven't found that. We're doing it in a staged process over 10 years, so we don't have too great a burden on the police budget in terms of the capital investment.
It's a difficult one, Jane, in that people in the past have seen these as sort of safe havens to use. One of the things we've got to do in reduced budgets is to move our debate from worrying about buildings to worrying about outcomes of spending money. I'm going to come back at the end and ask you about why you couldn't provide us with information on spend that we wanted, because that would help us decide matters. That's not to say that the buildings aren't important, but they are secondary. They may be secondary in achieving our objectives, which is actually controlling and reducing our social behaviour. The lady, again, name.
I'm from the St James Centre, just to reassure you, we are exploring options for supporting police to have some kind of base within the North End at the St James Centre at the moment, very early stages, but those conversations are happening.
But just to come back with that, will this facility take place within the St James' Centre?
Yes.
Yeah, which closes 5.
No, not all the time.
No, right. Because what my concern would be that the police presence would depend on the opening times of the thing, and that these scallywags, want to put a better word, they've got an operator shift system. They're active all the time. So, you know, the police presence would be, you know.
I think what we are looking to provide in a community police station is not a base that will be open every day and used by the force, but a place where police officers or PCSOs will be guaranteed in an advertised surgery to be available for the public to come and talk to. And the feedback I got from the public was that the fact that the force had closed all its general inquiry desks meant that the public felt the force had moved away from them in their locations. Now, what we don't want is officers, few as they now are, whether they are PCSOs, general inquiry officers, or police officers, tied to buildings when we need them out working in the street with housing officers, social workers, and all of the others who are working to reduce antisocial behaviour. So what we've found in other areas where we have community police stations, there will be a modern, in the window of if it is finally agreed, it's a community centre, St James's, thank you, ma'am. You're Anna. Sorry. It's
not
a
like that.
If that is the place that is decided upon, what we intend to do is to have a modern digital way of telling the public when the surgery is going to be, advertising it on a screen so that it will be regularly updated, including information about recent crime trends when the public are being engaged with and asked for information. So that's the model that we're going to be implementing. I haven't got one I can show you yet on the world, but we're working hard to deliver it. As soon as we do, we'll invite you to come and have a look.
Okay, thank you.
Really good. So we keep that on the agenda because I'm now that we're all interested how that idea develops. But we will have one of the suggestions is from Tony, any new monies we spend, we consult with people on the receiving end of antisocial behaviour to suggest what might be done. And I know it won't be polarised like this, but any choice could be opening, whatever that means, Laird Street Police Station, or following the suggestion of making sure we have more policemen operating with the community support offices. I think it'd be interesting where the debate actually went on that.
That's an interesting question, although the problem we are facing is that employing police officers long term is a resource budget implication, whereas if you build a building, it's a one-off capital cost and then you have a living cost on it. So slightly different budget implications.
It is. Well, we've got some revenue to spend, not capital.
Okay, good.
And we spent it in the past by paying for
certain needs.
Thank you, Chair. I used to be a voluntary community support officer and done quite a lot of training in Manor Road, and then I ended up in Heswell actually, but you're supposed to end up in your local community. I'm just wondering, are we looking back into that again? That was about 2005, 2006, the community support, voluntary community support officers.
Jane?
I'm not sure if we have any volunteers. I'm looking at the inspector. I don't think we do, but I think it's something that maybe consider. I'd be happy to take that away.
Thank you. Any other suggestions or comments, Jane?
Yes.
Jane, just a quick question. Early mentioned a number of initiatives, Positive Futures and I think the Sports Development Fund. If you were in a position to put additional resources in a particular area to help young people to avoid antisocial behaviour and crime, where would you put it?
I would probably, it depends, if it was the, I've got two funds, one is the Property Act Fund, which is a small budget of about £80,000, and the other is a budget that I've set aside for bigger projects, but I invite bids. So we look at the bid, we say what we're looking to do, and we invite bids. And we try to make sure we put some money into all of the five boroughs of Merseyside. Having said that, out of the force has agreed since I was elected that the Community Safety Fund that had previously been ring-fenced under the government up to 2010, and then after 2010, around about 2012, the ring fencing of that was removed. So the police used to dedicate about £2.9 million of their budget to supporting initiatives that local authorities across Merseyside would primarily take the lead on deciding how that was spent. We've maintained that. So although the budgets have been reduced significantly, we have actually kept the amount of money that we ring-fence for that budget. It's just about, it's one of the few bits of continuing support that community safety teams now in the local authorities still have that isn't local authority money. And that fund is decided by the community safety partnership in that area. So I allocate the funds, hand it over to local authority colleagues, and they then work with the police and other partners in the area. So I don't actually take decisions to that extent. I tend to leave that to local people who know better than I do what the priorities are. And I assume Birkenhead sees a significant amount of the fund that comes to the will.
We will check that.
I mean,
one of the problems we've had, Jane, is my question to you. We're starting an exercise looking how the 16 national budgets are spent in this constituency, one of which is the crime order, the disorder budget.
Yeah.
And when we asked from the police and we asked from you, what was the breakdown of their budget in respect to antisocial behaviour, you quite openly replied that even if we did a Freedom of Information Act, we wouldn't get any because we don't collect any data. And we haven't, similarly, whereas others slightly more reluctantly began to provide us with information because they're collecting it in a different way for us, we've got a blank wall with the police and with, through that, and your budget as well. Can we ask you to take away, in a sense, to think about how can you fulfil your duties as crime and police commissioner if you don't know the sort of detail that we were after how much of the police budget is actually over the years going to counter antisocial behaviour? You know, all the difficulties of categorising the budget, but in Birkenhead, while of course everyone's horrified about the drug trade and the movement through the port and about grievous bodily harm and murders, the thing that affects us more, as the papers show, is what antisocial behaviour does. You emphasise it at the beginning, devastates people's lives and so on. And they've been respectable, expected to be able to spend their days happily, and they're not. Can we ask you to take that point away?
The problem we had, and I know the force wrestled with this, and I know you've had conversations with the force representatives on the work. We've tried to do it. We probably could get you an idea of antisocial behaviour spent across the whole force. What we struggle with is saying, in Birkenhead, this is how much is committed.
So could we settle for the first beginning?
I think we can, possibly, yeah.
It's very helpful, it's strong.
But you see, as one of the things that drives the force behaviour is the figures that I've shared with you, which show antisocial behaviour coming down, that is reported antisocial behaviour, and consequently, when the force is inspected, they are inspected by people who want to see how they're performing in relation to the highest risk areas, which, according to these figures, are not antisocial behaviour. I just put that in front of you because it's one of the challenges I face, where I come to public meetings and I know from what people tell me that although the figures show one thing, people don't feel as if their neighbourhoods are calmer and quieter.
No, and one of the reasons may be, Jane, that people just give up hope in reporting. I mean, what we've had in our papers, there's been a huge background paper which Tony did for us, showed that we're really good on process, how we recall, where we look and all the rest of it. But what we all want is outcomes. How are we stopping that behaviour? And we have one extreme example. I had one I actually took up where over years somebody was filling in a diary.
Yes.
And at a public meeting, the police said, but you don't fill in your diary. And I was absolutely flabbergasted. And I turned to Angela and said, Angela, is this true? And she said, yes. And I said, why? And she said, well, I filled it in for 7 years and nothing happens. And I thought, God, you lasted 7 years before you gave up. Now, that Angela, who now, thank God, escaped only by moving from the horrors that she inflicted upon her. I would have given up long before 7 years were up, Jane. So I would cease to report it. But it doesn't mean to say the issue is going on. I just think it's very possible reporting it. And that's what worries me about the data. And I know there's no way, easy way around it.
It would be interesting to know whether people in this audience felt that people were reporting it less. But equally, I thought reading through the summary of interventions was really interesting because actually what the interventions hint at is that enforcement and antisocial behaviour orders at the hard end of policing is less impactive on reducing antisocial behaviour than the early interventions, particularly working with the whole family, which the police can contribute to, and perhaps we're moving more towards that as we develop multi-agency.